This vast expanse of blue is the South Pacific, and this boat is ours. The Windsong is one of the loveliest sailing vessels to cruise these enchanting seas. A dazzling four-master, 134 meters long, with 2,000 square meters of white sail puffed out by the trade winds. The Windsong will take us from island to island to discover the last remaining paradise on Earth, Tahiti, and its Polynesian archipelago. In Tahiti, everyone sings and dances. The Tahitians being a resourceful people, even an overturned tub can be used as a base. Any excuse will do, and wishing you a warm welcome will do very well. The town of Papeete, seat of the local government, is always bustling with activity. In addition to the island's native Tahitians, it's populated by people from the Marquises, Tuamotu, Gambier, and the faraway Austral Islands. Lured by the illusion of the city, these inhabitants, over 100,000 in number, keep things in perpetual motion. The best spot to meet and talk with them is at the market, Papeete's famous marketplace, point of affluence for the myriad products of the islands.
This particular area of the Papeete market is dedicated to those planning to go out at night, to a disco or a cocktail party. Here they will find head crowns, also called hypos, headbands. And what is most interesting is that the variety of colors found here will enable you to buy a crown that will match your clothes. Here the ladies are fabricating what we call terre-peri necklaces. The flowers come in from Moria in small packages like this, and they're wrapped in this big leaf. They're kept that way so that they will not open up and lose their scent. Look at this. There are about 100 flowers inside.
Flower garlands are just one example of a Polynesian culture which still flourishes today, as explained to us by the curator of the Tahiti Museum, Manouche Lehartel.
I think the main characteristics of the Polynesian culture is its language, a language that is extremely vivacious and spoken today by approximately 95% of the population living in this country. It's a language that is used daily, but that can be found also in the songs. Songs that, as in the past, play an important role because the Polynesian likes to sing and likes to dance. So song, dance, music go together. There has always been, for instance, in the Marais, great religious ceremonies where the people sang, danced and played music.
No, it isn't the Windsong on the open sea. Before our four-master sets sail, we have ample time to ford the rivers in a four-wheel drive to explore inland Tahiti, where long, steep-sided valleys abound in running streams. Here we are in another world. Scenery out of a primeval age with cascading waterfalls that appear without warning. For example, at Topatari, whose name means in the very picturesque Tahitian language, water that gets its face smashed in. In very little time, we've gone from sea level to an altitude of over 1,000 meters. The route soon becomes rough, and the four-wheel drive proceeds with difficulty along the mountainside. On such a tiny island, it takes only 20 kilometers to reach the end of the world. With Teva, our guide, we head into a wild valley.
We're now in the Papenu Valley, a few kilometers away from the coastline. We had to cross rivers several times, and we are now at the center of the island, in the old caldera, or volcanic crater, dominated by the mountains Tetufera, Urufa, and Maomaite.
Like most Polynesian islands, Tahiti is actually a volcanic rock. Starting under the sea, the volcano eventually rose above the waves. This relief is typical of a young island. Over the years, we're speaking in millions of years, the volcano we're now on will become too heavy. It will gradually sink back down and return to the sea. The Polynesians do not often go up into the mountains. The heights are haunted by ghosts, they say. So they prefer to turn their backs on this jagged landscape, remaining at sea level to savor life down on the balmy shores. Venus Point. The men are busy. Preparations are being made for an event which the Polynesians take very seriously, the Teaito, one of Tahiti's most celebrated canoe races, whose coach, Gebilu, is also one of its most enthusiastic promoters.
Our ancestors traveled a great deal in canoes, and this is how the idea of organizing district races was born. This led to higher level races, in particular for the Heiva festival in July.
And off they go. This is a spectacle not to be missed, for the canoe is an essential part of Polynesian culture, an object which is greatly revered. Without canoes, the Maoris, who set out 3,000 years ago from Southeast Asia, would never have reached these Oceanian lands. These canoe paddlers are adulated like stars, in the same manner as a football or tennis player's. Herculean strength is needed to paddle like this during the race. It would last 2.5 hours for the best paddlers, up to 4 hours for those who finish last. And this all happens in a coconut hull that can break if hit by a wayward paddle or by an overpowering wave. No luck for this one. The greatest canoeing star in Polynesia, in the entire South Pacific, is this man, Louis Laughlin. Compared to him, Michel Platini, Boris Becker, or Carl Lewis don't even come close. He's won all the trophies, leaving his fellow competitors, as we can see, very, very far behind. We still have a few more hours before boarding the Windsong, just enough time to take a final trip around the island. The ground, which is covered by humus, provides a particularly fertile medium. Heat and humidity generate a greenhouse effect which accelerates vegetation growth. So all the right conditions for producing intense, luxuriant vegetation are found here. 22 kilometers outside of Papeete, this is the blowhole. The waves rush with great force into the basalt tunnel, creating a powerful burst of water on their way out. Even more astonishing, up on the Taravao Plateau is this incredible Tahitian Normandy, where cows graze on prairies dotted with eucalyptus trees. In certain areas, nothing seems to have changed since the last century. The little churches still look like children's toys, models for electric train sets. Thank you. truly, nothing has changed. Not since the time of these old photographs. Not since Queen Pomare was the reigning monarch of Tahiti during the Protectorate. Not since this Edenic period, which was immortalized by the painter Paul Gauguin. In the delightful museum named after him, found on the south side of the island of Tahiti, copies of his famous paintings depict the eternal ideal of Polynesia. Everything lies in the fullness of gesture, of movement, in the gentle, warm, sensual harmonies of form and color. And now come out of the museum. Listen to Aiva's opening chants breaking the silence. Aiva is a period of celebration which goes on for a month, from the end of June to the end of July. Listen to the chants, and just think, Gauguin heard some of the same. At this late hour of the night, the toeri, Polynesian drums, become more and more insistent. Tamoe beats faster, the gestures become more and more explicit, for a true language of the body and hands is expressed in Tahitian dance. Tahitian dance is an invitation to love. The wind song sails through the Pacific night. Tomorrow, the island of our destination will appear on this radar screen. On the deck, moist with dew, lingers the smell of flowers and of damp earth. This is the upe, the wind that blows down from the hills, carrying far out to sea and right up to us all of the scents of the islands. We come to a place which the Tahitians themselves venerate, one of the best preserved sites in the archipelago, the island of Wahine. The windsong's arrival is always a spectacular sight. Here we're in a tiny harbor called Phou, and docking the boat is a big event. We're 175 kilometers northwest of Tahiti, light years away from any turmoil or hustle and bustle. The arrival of the huge four-master unsettles life on the little island, which, more than any other, incarnates the Polynesia of yesteryear. However, if we don't want to miss an important moment of Tahitian life, we must hurry. It's Sunday morning. and this is a unique moment. Here it is. Tahitians are mystical. At least 12 religions are found in Polynesia, with a majority of Protestants and Catholics. At the Sunday morning service in Huahine, spruced hats and bright clothes are the rule. To praise the Lord, the Tahitian women earnestly sing out their imene, the local translation of the word hymn.
Fare is the village of Huahine.
The house is also called Fare.
Yes, the house is also called Fare in Tahitian.
How is it built?
First you find a supporting pole. Then you cut the haito that will hold the coconut leaves on the roof. The Fare is not closed like the brick or cement house. There is always a fresh breeze going through the local houses. Since they're open, there is always some air entering the house.
In Huahine, more than anywhere else, time seems to stand still. The ladies act like young girls. The roads cut through practically untouched rainforest. Back in the valley, we discover a plantation where a prized fruit is grown using traditional methods.
The vanilla is from the same family as the orchid. Actually, they are similar to creepers that need a living aid in order to reproduce themselves. This is what you call an acacia albizia. After several years of research, it was found that the acacia was the only aid that allowed the vanilla flower to grow properly. Flowers start to blossom 2 years after the plant is set. The plant produces flowers for 7 years. After that time, you have to reset your plantation. This is a vanilla flower. We are going to marry the vanilla by hand. This is the flower's pistil, and this is the pollen. We remove the pollen, we put in the pocket underneath, and that's it. The flower has been pollinated. It takes 9 months for the flower to produce a pod, which is ready for drying process. The vanilla is often compared to a woman because it needs 9 months before it can be used.
One day, according to legend, the goddess Huahine was being pursued and she took refuge here in order to give birth. She then gave the place her name. And if you look hard enough, you can even see her in the form of the mountain, lying on her back, ready for childbirth. Here, you're on the most peaceful island, where the pace of life has yet to change. The Phounanui Lake reflects serene indifference. In the churches, the same chants from time immemorial. partly submerged triangular constructions are fish traps, which were built several centuries ago. Recently restored, they're still used by the fishermen. Across the bridge that spans the lake, we find the graves of Polynesian soldiers who died for their island in 1846. Always tidy, conscientiously whitened. Close by, a well-preserved site used in the ancient Polynesian religion, a marae.
Behind us is the marae manu'i. This building is used for the traditional Polynesian rituals. It's what we call a marae. These stones, that we call popas, come from plates that can be found on the shores. You'll see many of these sites in the Society Islands, built by the water. Why? Because in the Polynesian spirit, the biggest marae is the sea.
Back on board the Windsong for other, more profane pleasures. Tonight, it's the captain's gala dinner. Uniforms, stripes, protocol, cocktails. On the social side, nothing much has changed on sailing ships. And it's still a delight to be a passenger. Even more so tonight, for there's to be a grand tamara. A Tahitian-style dinner, lavish as is the custom in Oceania, and simmered for 4 hours. Succulent pork, sweet crayfish, glazed chicken, swordfish, grupu, caring, small red bananas, and wild spinach. All night long, coconut milk and champagne will flow. Enter the lagoon of Raiatea through the Te Awe Moa channel, the same taken in the past by the Maori in their huge canoes, come from faraway shores to colonize the island. Raiatea, the first island of the chain to be settled. Raiatea, the sacred isle. At the marae, Tapu Tapuatea, we meet a man in love with his island, Mr. Brotherson.
You know, the first white people came here in the 1700s. The big boats came here through the Te Awa Moa Pass, the sacred pass. They dropped anchor here in front of Raiatea, which is a sacred island, because all the great ceremonies took place here, and in particular on the headland in front of the big marae. Now, this place here is the entrance of the marae, and this is where all the visitors sat down, on these stones, while their chiefs settled near these standing stones.
Venaient
They came from islands as far away as New Zealand, Hawaii, Samoa. Behind us is a small particular temple where slaves and war prisoners were sacrificed to the Horo god. The Raetaeans sent wood on the reef, mainly coconut balls because it produces lots of heat, much, much more than coal. And once it was really hot, they poured water on it and it crackled. Then they used levers to remove the stones that were then brought over to bamboo rafts, rafts that could carry up to 5 or 10 tons. And this is how they handled these stones. The mountain or volcanic stones are something else. For these, they used their strength, and it was the high priest who had powers of levitation.
These volcanic mountains with formidable shapes thus presided the birth of Maori culture over 3,000 years ago. Among them were created the legends of these people. One of them being the arrival of the very first couple.
The departure to New Zealand took place by accident. A man called Tupe with his wife Hina, their child and their dog went fishing in this pasture in front of the Faroa Bay. All of a sudden, they feel their canoe moving. Then they're taken to the high seas, and the canoe goes on for days and days. They then realized that it was a great manta ray that had dragged them all the way to New Zealand.
The wind song maneuvers through the lagoon that belongs to both Raiatea and Taha, for their twin islands. The giant four-master encounters another sailboat come to lay anchor in these calm waters. It's the famed Antarctica, owned by the explorer Jean-Louis Etienne, who's back from a mission at the pole. On the Wind Song, it's time for writing postcards, making purchases in the shipboard boutique, or just browsing. In fact, everyone's waiting for tea time, for we've been promised a surprise. And what a surprise! A troop of young Tahitian girls, each as cute as can be, will give us a tamore demonstration in the main lounge. As a passenger struck by such childish sensuality remarks, very promising. Thank you. Since we still have several hours to go before reaching Bora Bora, Captain Martin Scott uses the time to give sailing lessons to any interested passengers. You want to learn how to pilot a 134-meter sailboat? Try, it's easy. You see, it practically steers itself.
And that should slow up.
Well, almost. Captain Scott actually has a very interesting point of view on these passengers.
Do you become teacher each week, is that?
Every week we do this, usually Wednesdays, if the weather's okay. Yeah.
And the passenger likes very much this moment?
The ones that do come up really do enjoy the experience. They're very overtaken by it, really. They think it's quite something to be able to steer a 5,000-ton ship.
What kind of question they ask to you usually?
Usually, I haven't done this before, what do I do, is the first question. But other people who own their own yachts enjoy the feeling of something much larger, and they appreciate that. They very quickly realize how to steer the ship.
The children who live on Bora Bora are very lucky. They play on the shores of what is considered to be the most beautiful lagoon in the world. Today, the wind song enters these famous waters. ...4,200 inhabitants living in a few scattered villages enjoy what has been called the Pearl of the Pacific. Bora Bora, the most sung about island in all of Polynesia. A 29-kilometer road, partially paved, goes around the island, allowing us to admire its resplendent lagoon, the color of emerald and turquoise. Rising above it is Mount Otemanu, a former volcano which was once much higher, but over millions of years it has slowly sunk down.
The main sight that attracts visitors to Bora Bora is the lagoon. You have a feeling that everything was measured, everything was done in harmony. So there's a lagoon, a reef, but also an island with an internal part. We have relics of the past left by the Americans during World War II. So with our 4x4, we can go up the mountains, enjoy the colors, stroll through the vegetation, the plantations. It really adds excitement to the drive. It makes it a little bit more adventurous. All this in the tropical vegetation with trees such as avocado trees or different kinds of pine trees like the falcata or the marumaru.
No superlative can convey the spectacular beauty of these crystal clear waters. Many writers, artists, men of science have bathed in them. Jack London, Alain Gerbeau, Paul-Émile Victor. The island's irregular coastline is lined with great carpets of sand. A canoe takes us out to the coral reef.
I'm slowing down because there are lots of corals, and that could damage the engine.
What is the depth?
In some parts, 1 to 1.5 meters.
Okay.
Here I'm carving a red tuna. It's what the sharks prefer.
That's what they prefer.
This is what the red tuna looks like. I have to cut it in small pieces. Otherwise, they'll eat it too fast. You're better off feeding them little by little.
Now Veru, with all this fish, is going to feed the sharks progressively. Here he's spreading the fish scent in the current so that the shark can smell it and come over. So here you can see the fish starting to come over, and progressively he's going away to draw it back to us.
I can see a shark already.
The sharks are here by the dozens. The channels sometimes become heavily infested, creating a veritable wall of sharks who are attracted by the food. In that case, it's better to begin a strategic retreat. Other underwater companions make much better company. Every diver will tell you this. Polynesia, seen from under the sea, is also a paradise. Here's a Napoleon, an enormous yet debonair fish, recognizable by its protruding forehead. Here's a swarm of sergeant fish, mullet, squirrel fish, butterfly fish, soldier fish, goat fish. And here, the stupendous flight of the manta ray, who, if it feels secure enough, will perform its gracious ballet right around you. The majestic ship heads towards the opening of Te Awanui, the huge channel, the only one that connects Bora Bora's lagoon to the open sea. On the other side of the reef, the ocean depths drop suddenly to 1,200 meters below sea level. Accompanied by dolphins, the wind song makes for the sea. After so much beauty, one is left a little dazed. A gentle torpor settles over the wind song. The passengers are overcome with a sense of idleness. A drink or two circulates, the crew dragnet fishes. Brian, the pianist, strikes a few chords. Well, you feel as if you have always been here, doing nothing, caressed by the trade winds. We have 20 hours of sailing ahead of us before arriving at our next stop. For few people are aware of this, Polynesia extends over an area of water which is as large as Europe.
In about 5 minutes' time.
Okay.
8:30 a.m. Captain Scott is on the alert because his task this morning is a tricky one.
Okay, on the wheel
We are arriving at Moria, and the Windsong must do some maneuvering in order to enter Cook Bay, gorgeous but difficult.
I'm looking at marks on the shore now. In fact, I'm looking at the ridge to the left of the mountain, and I get it in line with one of the major marks on the shore. And that's the, it's a slightly narrower channel into Cook's Bay, and it's got an angle in it. You've got to go down one way and then turn slightly sharply to the right.
And then when we can see into the bay here, we'll turn and come in on these marks here till we get to there, and then we come down to there to anchor, and that's the end at that point.
This is impressive maneuvering. The Windsong slips between the edges of the historic bay that James Cook came to in 1774, a bay that cuts deep into the island with its sculptured mountains. Here's the most amazing of them all, the mountain pierced by the spear of Phou, a legendary hero. In the caves scattered around its side were buried the princes of the past. For the many artists that live here, Moria is the island of eight radiations. It's so named because of its contorted relief, which breaks up the sun's rays. Approaching Moria from the sea, as we did, is an unforgettable experience, as Manouche Lehertel explains.
The best way to discover Polynesia today is by coming in from the sea. When the sun rises, to enter through a pass and see the mountains bathed by the sun, to see a beach, oasis of calm and serenity. When you come in from the high seas, from the current, and pass the coral reef, I can understand why the first navigators were moved by what they saw and spoke of Eden, of paradise on earth.
After a quick transfer in a tender of the Windsong, which cannot moor alongside the quay due to the shallowness of the bay, we set off to explore the inner part of the island.
We are in the Opunohu Valley, at the center of a vast archaeological area where the Marae Ahu Umaine is also located. You can see all around these remnants, the trees that are in Tahitian are called mahi, or Polynesian chestnut tree. In the past, Polynesians used these trees to communicate. They took a rock and hid the root that way. The message could be relayed through several persons. Otherwise, you could use a shell called a conch, and the message could be transmitted much farther. In this forest, you also find the tihariye, that we call the bankuli nut. The ashes produce a black color that is mixed with a liquid to give the ink used for the old Polynesian tattoos. Since the old days, the Polynesians have practiced the art of tattooing. As a matter of fact, the word comes from the Polynesian tatau. In the past, each archipelago had its own shape of tattoos. Nowadays, many Polynesians wear tattoos not only to decorate their bodies, but also to find a cultural identity.
This specialized tattooer works in the traditional way. He pricks his patient's skin using a sharp-toothed comb made of bone and a small mallet. He then fills the tiny perforations with ink, and this creates the tattoo. For dyes in the past, he would have used bark, flowers, or a charcoal mixture. His patient might not have made it through.
It's a cow bone. I carved it to make my needle.
This tattoo for me is like an identity card. It is my identity of Polynesian people, of Maori people.
In the past, the long narrow valleys of Moria were used for growing vanilla. Today, this crop has given way to the pineapple. And to the cultivation of the chiare flower.
They start to blossom in the afternoon, around 1 or 2. The picking takes place in the morning.
Why?
Because the flowers are very, very pretty.
Actually, do you pick the bud or the flowers?
We pick the bud. If you pick the flower, you make monoi.
The tiare is a small, white, highly fragrant gardenia which has long been the perfume symbol of Tahiti. It's used in the making of an internationally renowned Tahitian specialty, monoi.
There are these flowers that have already been picked and dried. If there's lots of sun, 3 or 4 days or a whole week, then she mixes it with coconut oil. Then she collects crabs, takes only the eggs out of the shell, mixes everything, and the sun does the rest of the work.
That's right. Since it's the sun that does all the work, there's nothing else to do but let it tan you. Using monoi, of course. Life in Polynesia is easy. But that doesn't mean that the Polynesians spend all day twiddling their thumbs. They invent things, like le truck. Le truck is what you see there, a truck made into a bus. A private venture, they belong to individuals, which, however, compensates for the lack of public transport. So you can get around the island in a jalopy lovingly decorated by its owner. Someone had to think of it. In Tahiti, everyone takes le truck. Pair of tuna, the result of a day's fishing. To eat it Tahiti style, it must be raw, diced and marinated in lime juice. Add tomatoes, onion, cucumber. Sprinkle with coconut milk. Try it, it's delicious. As for this enormous Coryphenus dorado, or mahi-mahi, it makes a tasty kebab. Oh, These last moments will be with you when the wind song's bells calls you back on board for the last time. You've met here a people in love with liberty. You're in possession of instant happiness, of the present moment, by the sea. And on the deck of the Windsong, on its way back, having understood all this, having taken it all in the instant of a heartbeat, with your nose to the wind, under the white sails fluttering in the breeze, you will have become Tahitian forever.